Thank you very much for coming. I should just start with a quick announcement to say that the speakers tonight will be filmed. And if there is time for discussion later, they may turn the camera around to get some shots of the audience, unless anyone is not happy with that. Does anyone particularly not want to be filmed or featured in that? Make yourselves known. Okay, so we've got one hand at the back there, so that's... Fine, thank you. And also, I should add that Mary is making a film for Momentum. So if you would be filming events, if you'd like to.
Also, I said the microphone at it.
It's Angela Eagle, it's a conspiracy.
Okay, how's that?
Better.
Okay, I'll just help you going. I was just saying that Mary will be, if anyone would like to speak to Mary about featuring in the film and talking to her afterwards, she is just there, and you can grab her afterwards to chat about that.
Just want some quick sound bites on why you're supporting Jeremy Corbyn. If anybody would just like to be on camera for literally 20 seconds to say why they're supporting Jeremy, I'm going to be doing some films at the end. So just come up to me at the end and I'll be back. Thank you.
So I'm going to just hand over to Sean for some housekeeping.
Thanks. Just in case of emergency, it sets the doors. If you turn left and continue left around, we'll come to the car park. If we just move into the car park, it's right over there. If it works the other way, someone from reception towards the right will come in and lead us out. So, at the front, thanks.
Okay, hi, I'm Sarah. I'll be chairing this evening, and I'm just going to say a bit about why we're here. So, you'll all know that we're all here to show our support for Jeremy Corbyn. He has a history of supporting many good causes that I'm sure we would also all support, and has often found himself on the right side of history. But we're here tonight because of the support that he, along with John McDonnell, have particularly shown for deaf and disabled people in our campaigns against austerity and for our rights. These days, disabled campaigners get quite a lot of attention and known for their high impact direct actions. But Jeremy and John have been there from the beginning at small demonstrations, vigils and meetings, lending their support and listening to what we have to say, often on issues that are desperately important to us, but that most people haven't even heard of, let alone cared about. It's not because it would make them look good or get them positive attention in the press, but because they know injustice when they see it and the importance of speaking out against it. As a result, Jeremy Corbyn's campaign has the support of some people who are both the most fierce and the most compassionate, and certainly the most well-organised that I've met over the last few years. And we're going to hear from some of them tonight. We're going to start with a message that Ellen's going to read from the activist and comedian Francesca Martinez.
Hi, so Francesca Martinez sends apologies. She's really sorry she can't be here with us tonight. So she says, yeah, I'm really sorry I can't be with you today. The way that disabled people have been treated over the last few years has made me ashamed of my government. At a time where we have the money and technology available to help everybody lead dignified lives, we have instead gone backwards. Disabled people have had vital support cut, benefits eroded, and been demonised as workshy scroungers. Lives have been destroyed, families ruined, and independence lost. Our corporate media have dutifully spouted this rhetoric of hate and have blood on their hands. This is a human rights abuse on a massive scale. Throughout these dark times, two MPs have been vocal opponents to these appalling policies. They have backed petitions, raised issues in Parliament, spoken up for the millions of us who have been voiceless, and turned up time and time again to demonstrations. Those two politicians are Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell, two men who spent their lives not courting power or privilege, but fighting for an equal, just, and peaceful society. They are rare politicians indeed, whose lives and actions back up their words. I'm proud to be supporting such decent men who prove time and time again they are in politics because they want to improve the lives of everyone. They, like me, believe that a society should be proud to support people of all abilities, that we should embrace diversity, and that caring for each other is what makes us civilized and humane. I hope that, together, we can create a culture where we can all flourish in our own unique ways. Diversity is beautiful, everyone is different. Francesca.
Thanks, Helen. So our first speaker tonight is Sean McGovern. He's a TUC Disability Councillor and a member of Unite.
Thank you tonight. I'm not from TUC, I'm from Unite. Okay. Okay. And I have a group there. TUC is non-political, so. Anyway. Right, about this time last year, I was in Brighton with Unite for its kind of first policy, I'm sorry, Rules Conference. And we had a meeting, the executive had a meeting to decide which MP we would go for the leadership of the Labour Party. And our executive pretty much unanimously chose a man called Jeremy Corbyn. Now, our leader, Lynn McCluskey, was, he wasn't quite sure. I think he was leaning towards Burnham, but the decision was made and he has stood behind Corbyn ever since. Indeed, he tried to broker the peace deal there last week, which, as we know, is almost a small town. Now, why did we go for Jeremy Corbyn? Mainly because we had seen years and years of Labour government, sorry, Labour Party in opposition, then in government, acting pretty much like people on the other side of the room, the Tories. Maybe a little bit, a few differences here and there, you know, austerity like that kind of thing, but ultimately still following neoliberal policies and politics. Along comes someone called Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell. And we now have two MPs, two leaders, that don't sound, and indeed don't particularly look like the people on the Labour Party, the Conservative Party. They're trying to change the way we do politics in this country. And I think this is the reason why there's been such an outrage from the Parliamentary Labour Party, because they don't quite get it. We've got two MPs here who actually do understand disability, they understand the social model, they get it. We've got 172 MPs out there, not all of them, but a lot of them don't particularly get it. And they don't understand either, they're there to represent us, not the parliamentary club they belong to. So we're in a situation now that we've got a parliamentary Labour Party that has lost confidence in its leader. We say actually we've lost confidence in the Labour Party in Parliament. For too many years we've been spoken down to by a party that is supposed to look to the poor, working down the working classes. They haven't done this now for a long, long time. They don't represent us necessarily, they don't look like us, they don't sound like us. And it's going to be a tough, tough fight for Jeremy. We have to get behind him. He will win the, whoever it goes to, it's Owen Jones now, isn't it? Owen Smith. Sorry, Owen Jones. Whoops. So it's Owen Smith who's going up against now. So Andrew Eagle, as we've heard, has pulled out of the race. He will win it. We then need to force our individual MPs, the Labour Party members, to go out there and to back him up. Helen Hayes, my MP, isn't a bad person, but she wrote a four-page letter saying why she wouldn't support Jeremy any longer. The fact is, they haven't got confidence in Jeremy Corbyn, because they don't understand his politics. And I think it's time now we have a leader, sorry, we have a party in Parliament that actually gets behind a leader and John McDonnell, two people who do understand the plight of disabled people in this day and age. And they've got some good people in there as well, Kate Osamore, Debbie Abrahams, people like that, who, you know, could make a really good front of his government if given the opportunity. I'll leave it there and keep up the fight. We've got to get Corbyn back. Well, he's already in there, but we've got to win this election. They're going to throw at him, And there's an election next spring. We've got to get out there and get the vote out to get Corbyn in to number 10. Thanks.
Is Geraldine O'Halloran. She's a deaf activist and co-founder of the Stop Changes to Access Talk campaign.
Sorry, I didn't realise I was next. Hello, so my name is Geraldine O'Halloran. I'm from Stop Changes to Access to Work. I want to talk about Jeremy Corbyn. I want to really share my personal view. So this is my view only. It's up to you to make up your own minds, but this is my personal view. I've always voted. I remember the first time I went to vote. I was so proud of myself for voting. And then later, I suddenly thought, these politicians, do they actually support me? And the message, does it include me? And what they're saying, is it directed to me? Is it directed to deaf, disabled, working class women? No, not really. So why am I voting? Just recently, I looked at the leaders, the prime ministers, and I felt, do they believe in deaf and disabled people? Do they think I can make a good contribution? Will they involve me in any discussions or debates? Really, the answer's no. So if I'm being honest, I don't care these people, these politicians, I don't care where they're from. I don't care if they're working class, if they're rich, I don't care. I don't care if their parents worked in a factory, I don't care. What school they went to, whether it's a posh school or an ordinary state school, I don't care. What I do care about is their message. Their message is important to all of us. We need to see them use the language that we understand. They need to involve us. They need to worry about us. They need to change the world for us. We have had none of that. But somebody now has come along. As Sean just said, and Sarah, they were talking about Jeremy being involved in disabled people's movement. John McDonald as well, they've both been here over the years. And it seems that we really have their support. For me, it looks like the future could be good. It means that we can be involved and they will listen to us. They won't use language that makes us feel bad, that makes us feel expensive, that makes us feel like a burden. Their language will be inclusive. We will be included in the debate. They'll share information and include us in discussions. So we have a leader. We have Jeremy Corbyn, who he's got respect for people. He understands our issues and makes sure they're on the agenda. He includes us in debate and discussion. We need to challenge the language around deaf and disabled people at the moment. We're not scroungers. I work. I work hard. I've worked hard all my life. I've been to training to improve my life and work opportunities. And most deaf and disabled people want the same. I'm not expensive. I've got rights. Jeremy Corbyn believes that as well. It's up to us to make sure he stays as leader. We need to support him and help him carry on to lead. When you're looking for leadership, what do you look for? You need someone that believes in you, and that is Jeremy Corbyn. He believes in us. We have to support him. Thank you.
Our next speaker is Claire Glassman. She's a disabled campaigner for over 30 years, active in fighting for the rights of disabled women.
Hi everyone. Reasons to stand, sit and roll with Jeremy Corbyn. Thanks, Mandy. Anti-austerity. Jeremy Corbyn is more pro-women than the women MPs like Yvette Cooper and Angela Eagle, who implemented austerity, which is sexist, racist, anti-disability. Yeah. Among women, single mums and their kids and single women pensioners are hit hardest. After a lifetime of work, 1 million pensioners are without home care. Those of us who do get services are charged for home care and day centres from our disability benefits. We are struggling without enough support. Without independent living, disabled women are forced into dependence on men who can become abusive. Unwaged carers are exhausted. The privatised carers are on zero-hour contracts, and many have become callous about our welfare because our lives are not valued, and neither is the caring work they do, and which we all need, everyone needs, at various points in our life. Yeah. Disabled women are mums and carers for elderly parents too, on top of coping with disability, but we don't get support. Mums asking social services for help are threatened with having their kids taken away. But Jeremy Corbyn is against these cuts and backs the recognition and valuing of women's unremunerated caring work. Angela Eagle abstained from last year's welfare reform and work bill that cut ESA and squeezed down the total benefit cap. John McDonnell said he would swim through vomit to vote against it. That's real leadership. We fondly remember the 2006 Labour Party conference in Manchester. John was the only MP to visit our picket against Labour's introduction of the Work Capability Assessment and ATOS. We didn't know then it would be genocidal. But last year at a meeting in Pontypridd, Owen Smith told activist Lisa Van Ziel that scrapping the Work Capability Assessment would make Labour look weak on benefits in the eyes of the media and so be bad for election chances.
Shame.
Shame. Shame. Owen Smith was a lobbyist for Pfizer, the drug multinational, pushing NHS privatisation and overcharging the NHS millions for epilepsy drugs. In Nigeria, Pfizer did drug experiments on children without consent, where some children were deprived of proper treatment and died. There was a big compensation case. Jeremy Corbyn is anti-racist. His first action after winning leadership was to speak at a rally for refugees. Women seeking asylum here, mostly ill, disabled and traumatised from the rape and other torture they escaped from, are put in detention, excluded from the main benefits system, dispersed out of London where they may have had a support network, and more often than not deported. Jeremy will change that. Before Black Lives Matter, Jeremy took up the case of Roger Sylvester, a bipolar man who was black, picked up by the police and suffocated by them when he was taken to psychiatric hospital. And just to mention, women of colour in the Global Women's Strike has done a list of why people of colour should support Corbyn and McDonnell. Anti-war. Last night, Jeremy Corbyn voted against Trident nuclear submarines. Just imagine what we could do with the £205 billion they're planning to spend on it. And some say they've already started that spending. Corbyn attracted thousands of people to the Labour Party because of principles like that. Corbyn apologised to Iraqi people on behalf of the Labour Party for the devastation of Iraq, to disabled veterans and bereaved families. A few years after the 2003 invasion, we heard from Zafar Khan, of the Limbless Association. Remember, he was the guy who brought Ali Abbas from Iraq to London to get a second chance. Zafar described the devastating effect of the breakdown of support and basic health services on people disabled by landmines and other bombs and by lack of medical care. He was negotiating with the World Bank to fund rehabilitation centres, but the World Bank was demanding surveys of need, which are impossible to carry out in war conditions. Since Blair, Labour has had a terrible record, especially on disabled people. They introduced many cuts, which the Tories have then driven further. We cannot trust any other candidate who can't show us their proven record. That's why we supported Jeremy last year and will again. It looks like they're attacking Jeremy alone, but Jeremy and John are our front line. They want to demoralise us and drive us out of campaigning so people die hidden from view. We refuse to die, and we refuse to suffer and be quiet. Jeremy for PM.
So our next speaker is Clara Payard. Clara is a member of PCS NEC and the PCS Disabled Workers Committee.
Hi, hello. Hello, I'm bringing solidarity from my trade union PCS. I'm from the culture sector, museum and galleries. And as you know, unfortunately, my union have got members in those terrible bodies like Atos and Maximus. But we've been very clear from the start that we totally oppose any cuts in, you know, disability benefits, welfare. And we've been very, very vocal about that. I'm a member of our Disabled Workers Committee, and what we see is that the discrimination is also going inside the workplaces, where we see performance assessments on workers with disabilities, and the discrimination on that is absolutely horrendous. We just had a research report that show that if you are disabled and you work in a government department, you are 75% more likely to be given a bad performance. We also see disabled people being pushed out of the door, forced to take redundancy, or the employer get rid of them through capability procedure, sickness management procedure. We need a clear commitment that, you know, we want to eradicate discrimination in the workplace. We also seen new cuts affecting the Equality and Human Rights Commission. And John and Jeremy have been very supportive of all our campaign to oppose those cuts. It used to be a budget of £70 million. It's now £17 million. And the number of workers in that Equality and Human Rights Commission has been cut down, meaning that they cannot monitor what's happening, or if we put complaints through, they are not able to actually uphold them and investigate. One of our PCS comrades, Zita Holborn, have launched a new petition telling the Labour Party to stop discriminating against black and ethnic minority members, against disabled members, and against women. Because when they are sleeping, because when they ask people to pay £25, it's affecting the poorest people, and it's having a disproportionate effect on those groups and on disabled people. She's also lodged a complaint in the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and that may be something that other people would like to do. So I'm happy to sort of share the letter and see if people want to use it and give their own twist. That's fine. I mean, concretely, what else can we do to support John and Jeremy? I mean, I think that people should join the Unite community branches. If you're not in a union, it's 50p a week, so you can actually win the Labour Party election if you register before the 8th of August, and it's only £2 a month. And also, it's a way to being involved with unions and activities. I also think we should think about how we involve more disabled people into this campaign. And one of the things we used last year in a big campaign I was involved in at the National Gallery is we used the solidarity pictures. I know lots of people do that, but I think it'd be a good way if, you know, we can do group photos or individual photos. People can do it in their home, wherever they are. That would be like maybe a good idea. I also think that one aspect of supporting John and Jeremy is to support the policy making. We were just told today at the PCS National Executive Committee that they're really struggling because obviously you've got all those 172 MPs who are cowards and they just, you know, let them down. So not only they're attacking them, but they're also letting down the Labour Party in opposing the Tories properly. So, you know, I think we are the experts on disability, and I'm sure John and Jeremy would say that. And so let's think about how we can come up with some really good policies that will help not only to get Jeremy re-elected as leader, but also as a prime minister. So let's think about that, and hopefully we can follow up with further meetings in the future. Thanks.
So our next speaker is Mary Griffiths-Clark, and Mary is from Momentum.
Hello, everybody. Hi. Thanks very much for coming tonight. It's really great that you all managed to get here at such short notice. Not everybody is able to get places at short notice, and I think the Labour Party needs to change, and it needs to be more inclusive. I was one of three disabled candidates to run in the general election last year, and it was really tough. I also heard on the doorstep again and again, if you're a disabled member and you offer to help canvass or want to be involved in campaigns, you're often overlooked and ignored, and that needs to change. It changes now. In Momentum, we welcome everybody. And we would really like everybody to be involved in the campaign to help get Jeremy re-elected, because it's only under the leadership of Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell and Diane Abbott and a left-wing slate that we will get true diversity in the Labour Party, because they are the only people that get it. In order to help people reach out and get Jeremy elected, I need your help. Tonight, I'm calling for your help to get involved in the campaign. Please register and email me at Momentum, get in touch. I can pass you my details at the end of today's session. You can email momentumdisabilityinquiries@gmail.com. Then I've got your details, and I can put you on our database of people who want to campaign. We really, really need as many people as possible to be involved in this campaign. If you have any friends or any family or any colleagues that also might want to be involved, please, please pass on details to them. Not everybody can go doorstepping. I've got ME. I can't always walk. Some days are better than others. And I know that there's plenty of people here today that have fluctuating conditions and have barriers which prevent them from being able to do regular Labour doorstep canvassing. But there's so much more that we can do in order to reach out to other people. It isn't always about doorstep canvassing. We can do lots of social media, we can write blogs, we can get videos out there, we can talk to people within our communities. We can be active. At Momentum, we've developed this app so people can do telephone canvassing
from the comfort of their own home, which is people like me, a complete lifeline in order to be able to participate properly in politics. By participating in this campaign, you can make a real difference. There's 11 million people with disabilities in the UK, and yet there was only 3 Labour Party candidates in the last general election out of 650 seats. That has got to change, and we need to be that change. On a final note, I wanted to make sure that lots of people had opportunities to participate in tonight's event. And some people couldn't make it here because of their disability. And therefore, if it's okay with you, I would like to read out some of the names of the people who have given messages of support for Jeremy and his campaign, so these people feel that they're adding a positive contribution to tonight's event. Simon Colwell says he's 100% behind Jeremy's vision for our country. John Morgan also adds his support. He wants more done for visually impaired people within the Labour Party, and I think we need to really think about that. Sam Challis would love to be here, but can't afford to travel. Moira Caffell also sends her support. Chris and Betty Birch said that they're too disabled to attend tonight's event, but last summer, their brains told them to vote for Corbyn, and they did, and they said they will again. Diane Lee said Jeremy is the leader we want and the kind of leader this country needs, and she's with him all the way. And on a final note, Michelle, I think, sums everything up. Michelle's housebound. She said she's never been politically minded until Jeremy became leader. But she says that Jeremy speaks to the very soul of people. He has opened hearts and eyes of the disillusioned and has given hope to herself and her children. She says that she believes with Jeremy as leader and then Prime Minister, we will have a place for all of us in this country where class and wealth no longer divide us. And she thanks Jeremy for igniting the fire within her and the people around her. And she has given her full support for his campaign. Please can we have a round of applause for the people who have made contributions.
Thank you, Mary. Our next speaker is Paula Peters from Disabled People Against Cuts. Many of you will know Paula, I'm sure. You may not know that today is actually Paula's birthday. Before she starts, would you all join us in singing Happy Birthday? I'm going to turn the mic off.
On the count of 1, 2, 3.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Paula. Happy birthday to you.
Well, to be honest, I've already had one birthday present, and that's Angela Regal dropped out of the Labour leadership. What better birthday present could I have than that? So, Orrin Smith, come on, do the decent thing. Quick. Okay. Right. Thanks to everyone for coming on such a hot day. And 45 years ago, I was born on a day such as this. And, you know, I've been campaigning since I was 8, and to have Jeremy and John, who are out there supporting us, has been something to see, you know. And, you know, I'd like to say that, you know, Deepak and deaf and disabled people have had unstinting support from Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell. Both have spoken out and voted against every policy the Tories have imposed on deaf and disabled people in the past 6 years. And it should be noted that Jeremy Corbyn has a long and established track record of standing up for what he believes in, of going against the flow when it matters, and backing the words in Parliament with actions. And Jeremy is the only Labour leadership candidate to have come out on the street to stand side by side with us at Deepak and deaf and disabled people in solidarity. And up to the Labour leadership elections in 2015, Deepak had a policy
of staying out of party policy. We had no party allegiance because that leaves us free to criticise all parties where they do not work in the best interests of deaf and disabled people and give them praise in the rare occasions when they actually do. The vote of the 20th of July 2015 of the Work and Welfare Reform Bill changed all of that. This is the bill, now law, that will strip away tax credits from people in work poverty. The bill that will introduce a benefit cap so severe that it may well lead to mass homelessness. The bill that will remove child benefit from families with more than two children, leaving mothers unable to provide for their children. And the bill that will take away £30 a week from deaf and disabled people in the work-related activity group of ESA, pushing them further into desperate poverty. Then, the then temporary Labour leader, Harriet Harman, instructed many MPs of the Labour Party to abstain from that vote. And most did. But it's important to stress and highlight that 48 MPs had the courage to stand up and vote against this bill. And at least we know that there are 48 MPs in the Labour Party who still have the principles and are prepared to fight for them. One MP on that list was Jeremy Corbyn, who stands out as the only Labour leader candidate with guts to fight that bill. Jeremy's been a long-standing supporter of DPAC and deaf and disabled people's rights. He's the only Labour leadership candidate with a record of support for us. He's always been there for us when it matters. And it's why during that leadership campaign last year, DPAC supported his bid to become Labour Party leader. And it's why we support him in his bid now to remain Labour Party leader. Both Jeremy and John have been in unstinting in their support for DPAC's Independent Living Fund campaign for the past 4 years, supporting DPAC's quest in the courts to challenge the government's decision to close the ILF, reverse the decision for its closure, supporting Court Visual, standing with us in solidarity, speaking on the megaphone and wearing ILF t-shirts, supporting the action in 2014 when DPAC occupied Westminster Abbey in the fight for independent living. And I want to thank John especially for his support that day. As 75 activists faced down 350 cots for over 6 hours. He was there watching proceedings and mediating with the police throughout, and he never left that action until the last activist left the grounds. And on behalf of everyone at DPAC, John McDonough, I want to thank you very much for that. Jeremy and Corbyn have supported and signed 47 early day motions since 2010 on deaf and disabled people's rights, and was co-sponsored with John McDonough on EDM motion 658 to keep the ILF open. And Jeremy and John have been there when DPAC had a national day of action against Maximus, or Maximus as we really knew like to call them, who took over the work capability assessment contract in March of last year. John was on the streets with us at our London action, and both Jeremy and John were there to see us when DPAC stormed Parliament in June last year in the fight for the ILF, and John spoke to us in the lobby area again this year when we went back and occupied Parliament for the second time after the budget in March with a demand that there are no more deaths from benefit cuts. And Jeremy and John spoke at the memorial service for the deaths of deaf and disabled people and people in mental distress due to the welfare reforms event of 10,000 cuts and counting. Whatever action DPAC has had, Jeremy and John have supported us. And I also want to pay tribute to John today. He has been unfailing and unwavering in his support to DPAC over the years, and he has earned the love, gratitude and respect of every DPAC member, and addressed the DPAC conference in 2014 where he was the keynote speaker, and he was made an honorary member of DPAC that day and presented with a DPAC t-shirt. Because Jeremy Corbyn has supported DPAC, we support him. Labour needs a leader, not a suit. The UK needs Labour to have a leader, who stands up for the ordinary working person. And deaf and disabled people need Labour to have a leader that will fight the evil the Tory government will continue to inflict on deaf and disabled people. And we need to have a leader that will listen to us and include us in policy making decisions, because it's nothing about us without us. However, and we haven't really talked about this much, and it's really important to stress this, we are very aware that even with the Labour Party led by Jeremy Corbyn, it won't be enough to bring about the change we want. And I point out to you all here today that both Jeremy and John advocate very strongly that change happens out on our streets, in our communities, that debate takes place out on the streets, in community centres across our country. And it's important to stress to you all tonight that we must, and it's vitally important to stress, continue the fight against this Tory government. And as you know, Deepak has a track record of doing just that. And as I'm sure you all saw last Wednesday, the 13th of July, along with our great allies and friends from Win Visible, the Mental Health Resistance Network, we organised the National Day of Action against personal independence payments with 17 actions outside ATOS and Crapitor Assessment Centre. And, you know, we had an action outside Capita HQ in Victoria Street last week. We shut down Capita front entrance. We blocked Victoria Street. Then we went down to the DWP at Total Street. We shut that down and blocked the road. Then we went down to Parliament and we shut down all the roads to College Green. And we saw the world's media there. And the area was roped off to stop us accessing the media. You don't hold deaf and disabled people back. We took back that space and we read out the names of all the deaf and disabled people and people in mental distress who've died under a Tory government. That is David Cameron's legacy right there. Disabled Workers Conference this year supports Black Triangle's quest to get the Scottish Police to prosecute Ian Duncan Smith, Chris Grayling and David Cameron to be brought to justice and prosecuted for the deaths of deaf and disabled people and people in mental distress. We must make it happen, and we must continue the quest to get the truth out about the cumulative impact of the cuts of deaf and disabled people. And to that end, Deepak invites you to our week of action, which begins on the 4th of September, called You Cut, We Fight, about the cumulative impact of the cuts of deaf and disabled people. And this is an appeal to all trade union members in the room. We need funds to put that action on so we can get as many deaf and disabled people out on the streets of that week of action. So this is to everybody listening on live stream right now. If you can donate to Deepak, we would really appreciate it. The website, www.dbac.uk.net. Press that donate button and start donating for our week of action, please. And I will end with this. We now call on all deaf and disabled people across the UK who are willing to resist the Tory government in any way you can. Sit, roll, stand up, and fight for disability rights, and tell this government enough is enough. And by building the resistance to the Tories and fighting back for our rights, we know, do we not, that we will have the continuing support of Jeremy Corbyn and John McDonnell to do exactly that. Thank you for having me all to speak to you all tonight. Solidarity, and here's to Jeremy and John. Good luck.
So while we're waiting for John to arrive, we'll go to questions and comments from the floor. Someone going to go around the mic, yeah. And over. Ellen?
Hello. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I used to work for the civil service and have experiences of unions there. I've had some bad experiences as well. I don't consider that deaf people are treated on an equal par, and there's a bit of a glass ceiling effect, whereas hearing people can progress and deaf people are always left in mundane jobs. We've been talking about Jeremy Corbyn, that he will support the disability movement. You know, for example, is there any reason why he couldn't make it today? Would it have been nice to have seen him?
It's a great thing that there are lots and lots of rallies happening around the country, and Jeremy can't personally be at every one of those. So many of them are happening sort of in his absence, but John McDonnell has said he will be coming. He's got lots of engagements, so he's fitting us in, but I think we're delighted that John's going to be able to come in person hopefully soon.
Thank you.
Okay, just saying about, you know, I've been watching the news the last week. I said most of the media have sort of said about, out of all the things, about Jeremy Corbyn and that. Why is it that, you know, the media, and we're not going to name any sort of names, basically, the broadcasters and papers or anything like that. But why is it at any time, the media are against Jeremy Corbyn anyway, and what's the reason for it?
Hello, I'm Stephen from Croydon North, Equalities Officer. We've had lots of emails from the 908 team, the office team at the MP's office, and the list of authorised people on the NDC is different from the list that was given away by Momentum on the weekend. And he said he's not from the list. And we got an ex-refugee from Danford who was trying to move on. Thank you.
So Stephen, you're talking about your MP, Steve Reed.
Yeah.
Right?
Hi, I'm Jan, and I'm the joint chair of the London Disabled People for Momentum. It's very nice to see so many people and see some old friends as well here. But okay, I'm not saying anything very new, but I do have here the 10 points Jeremy stood on. If you want to just make sure everything he stands on is good stuff. And that's why I'd say to you who are not already in political parties, even if they say, oh, you won't be able to get to vote, there are ways, with the help of Unite, you can get to vote for Jeremy. And They won't just leave him alone. If him and John get through this bit, we still have to campaign and fight onwards. So it's not just a matter of the next few days, it's a matter of grassroots campaigning for a long time. But how wonderful it would be to have a political party that believed in doing that. I've never been able to, I've just recently rejoined the Labour Party because grassroots campaigning is what I do. I'm the chair of my retired members in my union throughout London. And it's so exciting to be with other, so many other people that know that grassroots campaigning is the only way we get change. So wonders to John and Jeremy, but wonders to all of us. And if you want to join up for Momentum, I have got a list at the back you can sign. But even if you don't, keep on campaigning with Deepak, which has always been strong and continues that way.
Yeah, I think I just want to echo a lot of what was said there, because I think there are times when we can forget how the relationship has gone, and I think we have to really try and understand what has made Jeremy such an important and key figure over the last few months. And I think that's to recognise the hard work that's been done by many of the people in this room and right across towns and cities across the country, literally for years and years now, in building a counter narrative, in creating spaces where people's own voices can be heard, where people's own stories can be told. And I think that has led to the situation where Jeremy has been positioned at the top of the Labour Party. Yeah, and we have to recognise just how powerful a voice that we are as disabled people, and the many miles we have travelled over the last few years, and really understand that now is the time to escalate that work, to step it up, to go back into our communities and bring activists and our friends and our neighbours and our work colleagues together, and actually say, what is it that you can do? What contribution can you make? What input can you have? What impact can you have in your community? And continue to do the work that has gone on and got us to the place, because there's a fight on for not just the heart and soul of the Labour Party, but for the heart and soul of our country. You know, and the truth is that we have to fight harder than ever. We have to fight more collectively than ever. We have to stand shoulder to shoulder, because if Jeremy doesn't get in, things are going to be strong and difficult. Jeremy does get in, it's going to be 10 times more difficult, and we're going to have a much bigger fight in our hands. Because let's not underestimate the forces that are going to be brought to bear and the support that we're going to need to show each other in that struggle. And it's called a struggle because it's going to be difficult. But we have to look to each other for solidarity, look to our experiences for a response, and look to each other for strength, and continue to do the things that have got us this far and will continue to get us further in the future.
Hello everyone, thank you very much. I'm here to talk about the deaf perspective, and there's a Facebook page and there's lots of comments about politics, and I've always supported Labour all my life, so has my family, and we support Jeremy Corbyn. We're really grateful, and he's the work that he's done in equal rights. The one issue for deaf people is that we can get confused, and that's because you rarely see an MP standing with an interpreter next to them, clearly going through the structure, what's expected, and all those kind of things. And it's like, if you want to support Labour and other parties and things like that, then we need to be able to access information, and sometimes information can be too complex. That's why I'm here, to support deaf people, to make sure that we have access to clear and accessible information. You know, we want MPs to stand there to make sure that information is accessible, whether it's interpreted or it's in a format that deaf people can understand. And it's important that people like Jeremy Corbyn continue the work in regards to deaf awareness and the impacts of benefits, things like that, and also the comparison and what's going on in Europe in regards to the UK. We're here to learn,
You know, when I was at school, I had no access to information in regards to politics. You know, I learned everything through my family. My family told me. And then when I joined the deaf community, when they talk about politics, they get upset, for example, through benefit cuts or various things like that. And but the issue is in terms of how they access politics on a general level. So I just think it's important, so that should happen. And we're subject to, you know, accessing the wrong information all the time because there's lots of misinformation. There's lots of pages for politics for deaf people on Facebook, but we need some clear information specifically for deaf people about Jeremy Corbyn on Facebook. And I think we can encourage activism and more members that way if we had a Jeremy Corbyn specific Facebook page for deaf people in accessing information. Yeah. Thank you.
There's a post I want to read out. We've been asked by some members who are Labour supporters to clarify the rules on voting in the upcoming Labour leadership election. Whilst we acknowledge that not all the Nugsley members support Labour, Nugsley is the National Union of British Sign Language Interpreters, for those who do, we need to clarify the following voting criteria. If you are a member of Nugsley and therefore a Unite member, then one of the three options apply to you. Option one, I joined Nugsley on or before the 12th of January 2016 and am a Labour affiliate supporter. You are therefore eligible to vote and will be contacted when the leadership voting window opens. Option two, I joined Nugsley on or before the 12th of January 2016, but I'm not a Labour affiliate. I would like to become an affiliate, so how can I vote? You can register to become an affiliate before the 8th of August 2016. You can do this online on the Labour Party website. Option three, I joined Nugsley after the 13th of January 2016. You must register to become a Labour supporter and pay £25. You can do this from Monday the 18th of July, 5 o'clock, until tomorrow, Wednesday the 20th of July, at 5 p.m. is the deadline. You can do so on the page. And remember, the link to register will go live from 5 p.m. on the 18th of July. So if you are a Nugsley member, before the 12th of January, and you're an affiliate, then you can vote, or you've got up to the 8th of August to register. But if you joined a union after the from the 13th of January onwards, you've got to pay £25, and you've only got till tomorrow till 5 o'clock to be able to register to vote to do that.
Can I just add that people who can't afford the £25 should email Momentum or contact Momentum, who are gathering people's representations about that. Can I just quickly, I think Ray was asking why is the media against Jeremy Corbyn? Because the media is pushing the government's agenda and big business priorities and the nuclear industry and everything, and military and everything else. So, you know, it's up to us to get the word out by talking to our friends and, you know, getting information out to counteract that.
Just to reply to your comment, I agree 100% that we need more politics. We need more interpreting for deaf people.
Sorry, is it on? Is the mic on?
Yeah.
Keep going.
Failed at the voice.
No, keep going.
Yeah, don't worry. Oh, it was your mouth.
Okay, thanks for good watching.
Right, I'll repeat myself, I'll start again. So I wanted to respond to the comment about interpreters and MPs not being able to access political information. So we have to fight for that. And it's interesting because in the last few months, Jeremy Corbyn, through his messages that he'd been sending out, the very quick messages, video messages, have all been subtitled. So it might be difficult, but there is some access there, and it's really worth reading through the subtitles because you'll get more information. They are all subtitled on the website, and pictures. Obviously, signing would be a preference, but...
But yeah, because the grammar, like English isn't the same as BSL, so it's not always accessible.
Can you repeat that on the mic?
Yeah, and also deaf people, they don't have a high standard of English.
There was one comment there about the... there was a comment there about deaf people not having good grammar in terms of accessing English and making sure that they can understand subtitles correctly. And so, you know, especially if they've been to deaf education, their English skills might not be too good. And there was another comment from Patsy. And don't forget, a lot of deaf schools are closed down and deaf children are in mainstream education. Therefore, they're a educational deficiency in regards to accessing information. Yes, deaf people can read, but in terms of getting the full access to information in the written form, you know, there is severe delays and things like that, you know. And for myself, for example, when I was voting in the Europe vote, I just got so confused by everything and it was all just last minute, and it's because I can't access information clearly and fully, and that needs to be considered.
I think we've got... We've got a comrade here, Ray Spiteri,
sorry,
Roddy.
Sorry, there's more deaf people there. I'm going to stand next to the interpreters. Next to the interpreter, that's the best place.
Sorry. So, just hands up, we've got a comrade here, Ray Spiteri, Roddy, lady behind Roddy, and Paul. Yeah, in that order. So, I'll take the mic and try and get out of the way of the interpreters.
I just wanted to make a kind of a comment rather than a question with regards to people who are deaf and hard of hearing. I classify myself as hard of hearing because I don't often require interpreters in these sort of environments, which are quite audible, but in more inaudible environments I require interpreters. I wear two hearing aids, but I do classify myself as hard of hearing. However, the point I wanted to make was last year, before I knew there were going to be four leadership candidates, I was sort of half supporting Andy Burnham, and I went to an event that he put on, and there was no interpreter, and there was no seats at the front, and I spent most of the evening at the back of the room wondering what was going on, getting very confused. And when I finally got to ask a question about the work capability assessment, I wasn't very happy with the answer. Fast forward to the event I went to where I heard quite a few great speakers speak, including Owen Jones, and I make that distinction very carefully. Owen Jones, a Guardian journalist. And he kind of lit a fire underneath me, and I thought, you know what, this candidate that he's kind of speaking out in favor of might have something to offer. But I knew nothing about Mr. Corbyn, apart from the fact that I had subliminally seen photographs of him in the papers over the last 32 years and didn't know it was him. And then I went to a smaller event and put my hand up and put my hand up and put my hand up, and the moderator didn't seem to see me. It was a very small event. There were only 400 people there, and about 20 of us had our hands up, and I put my hand up like this, please notice me, and nobody noticed. The moderator didn't notice anyway. Mr. Corbyn noticed, and he noticed and made sure I was come to first, and then the question was about the WCA, and I was very happy with the response. But going back to deaf awareness, There was an interpreter in that room. There was an interpreter in the room where I saw quite a few people speak out in his favour, including Owen Jones and Brian Eno, and I think Diane Abbott was there that night, Ken Livingston, and quite a few other people. There was an interpreter in that room. I went to see Ben Okri talk to Mr. Corbyn about poetry the other night, and there was an interpreter in that room. I have had the enormous privilege of going to a dinner, which a friend of mine who is a counsellor in Bristol invited me to. And I had an even greater privilege of being invited to sit next to Mr. Corbyn for a few moments. And interpreter was not needed because Mr. Corbyn is probably the only politician I've ever met who has deaf awareness skills. And by that I mean being able to communicate in a non-verbal way in a very loud, noisy dinner party environment. So I just wanted to put that out there. Oh yes, I met Owen Smith. Owen Smith, the person running against him, or Labour leader, I should differentiate. And I asked him if I could get involved with something called Disability Labour, which is an initiative put forward by Debbie Abrahams and Reema Patel. I told him about all the things that I'd been doing since Mr. Corbyn put me on Parliament's mailing list, and I basically showed him my Labour Party card and just explained my credentials in terms of my desire to get involved. He took my details, said he would be in contact after he spoke to Debbie, and guess what? Nobody got back to me, and I ended up having to pursue the situation myself. So I just wanted to put that out there. Just make of it what you will.
Grace Viteri, TSSA saying co-chair of TUDAN. I have to say that I didn't feel able to join the Labour Party for many, many years, because as a socialist, their policies under the likes of Blair and Brown seemed to me to be virtually indistinguishable from the Tories. And so I really didn't feel at home there. But I said to my friends, many of whom are long-serving Labour Party members and who tried to persuade me to join, I said, if Jeremy wins, I'll join. He won, and so I joined. Luckily, before the 12th of January, so I have a vote. I'm very glad that I did. Jeremy's policies are progressive. He supports disabled people. He supports poor people. He supports people that are disadvantaged in our society, something we desperately need in this country. And we need Jeremy, not merely as Labour leader, though yes, of course we need him for that, but we need him as Prime Minister. We need a socialist government in this country, because that is the only thing that is going to right the wrongs that have been put on us by both, starting with Thatcher, and then, I'm sorry to say, by Blair and those that followed.
Yeah,
so we need justice, we need socialism, and to get that, we need Jeremy. One thing I would say to you, I cannot get my head around the logic behind these MPs. I don't understand it. They're rebelling against Jeremy, and then they're blaming him for the fact that there's a rebellion. In other words, they're blaming him for their own actions. I want them to stand up and take responsibility for their own actions, bringing the Labour Party into disrepute, failing to fight for ordinary people that the Labour Party was set up to do. The £25 membership, affiliation fee, is an outrage. I'm a member of Momentum.
Outrage.
It's an outrage. I'm a member of Momentum. And like many people, I've spent my time on the phone, phoning around, canvassing people. And many people have said to me, I want to support Jeremy, I believe in what he does, but I'm unemployed or I'm a student and I just can't afford it.
That's right.
It's those people are being disenfranchised.
That's right.
Who is the Labour Party set up to fight for? The rich and the powerful or ordinary people like us? This is a disgrace. Also, I want to know why it is, as a Labour Party member, My CLP has been meeting has been cancelled, and my ward meeting has been cancelled, so I have no opportunity through the democratic structures of the Labour Party to comment on the outrageous actions of our MPs. I want to know why that's been going on. That's the question. Why am I being disenfranchised in terms of being able to attend CLP and ward meetings? Thank you.
Hi, my name's Roddy Slora. Can I just really like to address one question in particular? My name's Roddy Slora.
This is
Could
you sit down? Could you sit down?
Sorry. Okay. My name is Roddy Slora. I'm from the UCU Disabled Members Standing Committee. And I wanted to make an observation, really, about the whole argument being that Jeremy Corbyn is unelectable. Now, as the previous speaker said, the rebellion against Jeremy Corbyn has been used as an argument to say why Jeremy Corbyn is unelectable. And that's a kind of logic which has been used in order to discredit Jeremy Corbyn's eligibility to be leader of the Labour Party. But I think that the obvious thing is, were it not for the fact that, I mean, the way you could look at it is a bit like this. If you dragged me through a field through of cow dung and then told me that I was too smelly to be presentable to polite society, it wouldn't really be my fault that I'd been placed in that situation, would it? And it seems to me that this is what's being done to Jeremy Corbyn on a daily basis by people. And let's not forget, this is not about personalities, really. It's about policies, all right? It's about people who want to see neoliberal policies continue to be enacted. It's about people that want to see the welfare state to continue to be privatised, destroyed and dismantled and sold off to the lowest bidder. It's about people who want to make sure that we don't end a situation where our government is continuing to support barbaric wars, and the leaders of which are let off scot-free despite being found to be absolutely complicit in the plans of what America has done in Iraq and everywhere else. So my point about this, therefore, is I would reinforce what Paula said. Everything that has made Jeremy Corbyn electable has been about the struggles of ordinary people. And one of the things that's made him electable in terms of disabled people's opinion is the struggle of disabled people themselves. I mean, we're all talking about Jeremy Corbyn having stood by people when they fight. The point is, if there wasn't a fight, there wouldn't be a Jeremy Corbyn, because Jeremy Corbyn wouldn't exist. Jeremy Corbyn exists because of the anti-apartheid struggle. That's what made him famous, because he got involved in the anti-apartheid struggle. So don't let's forget, it's the struggles that bring people to the front that matter, not so much the people at the front. And therefore, everything that we do to support, if you like, the trumpeter trumpets for an army. We are the army. Don't let's forget that. And therefore, everything that we do has to be about continuing to build all the struggles that will make it more likely that Jeremy Corbyn and a decent, half-decent Labour Party will get elected to office.
My name is Gwyn. I live in Newham, where the services for people with disabilities are absolutely disgraceful. And we have a
100%. I can't hear very well.
Is
it might work.
Yeah.
We can't hear.
Close your mouth.
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes.
Right. What I want to say is that I suggest that we not only support the 10 policies that Jeremy has put forward, but we copy his example in a way that is very difficult. One of the things that happened early in his campaign for leadership, which makes him a very different kind of politician, was he was asked by a journalist to, in fact, rubbish some of his rival contenders. And he says, I put forward policies. I attack wrong policies. I do not attack personalities. Never have, never will. And he has kept that superbly. All through, he's been rubbished, he's been insulted, he's been misrepresented, and he keeps talking about the policy. Now, we have to admit that some of us, of his supporters, are not being as scrupulous. There is a tendency, because in the opposition there are such dreadful people, of getting diverted into attacking them as people. I was aware of this as recently as last night. You know, one of the speakers started talking about the opponents instead of talking about Trident. And so this is an appeal, and I particularly appeal to activists in Momentum, because you do have influence in guiding people who are new to the struggle. Jeremy Corbyn is not insulting anybody. He is not criticizing individuals as individuals, although he could if he wanted. That he is choosing a new, clean type of policy where he's even inviting his opponents, think again, because this is where these policies are. That is why when he got first elected, he didn't sack anybody. He said to them, we can debate in cabinet. Now, they've taken themselves off, they've resigned, good reasons. But he appealed to the good in everyone. You can change. Look at this policy, it's right. And the issues were most illustrated last night on an issue that is not complex. Things like the European Union, the referendum was complex. You know, I voted for Remain, but there are things wrong with the European Union. And so Jeremy, because he is an honest person, wasn't as enthusiastic as if he'd been 100% without an union. He's been criticised by that, by the Blairites, because they don't understand honesty. But last night, there was a very simple issue. When the present Prime Minister was asked, would you give the order that meant that thousands of innocent men, women and children would be killed, without hesitation, she said yes. Jeremy Corbyn was asked, if you became Prime Minister, would you press the button to order Trident? He said, no, never. There are parts of this campaign are a straightforward campaign of good versus evil. We don't need ever to sink to the methods of our opponents. Yeah. We don't need nasty tweets and death threats to opponents. We don't need to go on about their private life. We don't need to insult them. We are supporting a good man with good policies, and let's follow Jeremy's example and try to campaign as cleanly and as consistently and as well as he does.
We've got Paul, Tomato, Mark, then there's a couple of messages from people who can't be here, and Roger.
Hello, there's deaf people at the front and deaf people at the back, but I'll come to the front so everyone can see me. I'd just like to respond to the issues about deaf education that was mentioned previously. When BSL was first recognised back in 2003, you know, we thought it was great and it was brilliant, but it wasn't full legal recognition. It was recognised as a language. You know, we thought everybody would be able to have increased access to education, but I'm just worried, especially now we've decided to come out of Europe, the impact on our human rights and all those kind of things and all these standard things that we took for granted. You know, and the impact on the cuts. I'm really worried about that. You know, I personally, I've had enough of the Tory party. you know, and I want Labour to get into power. And, you know, Jeremy Corbyn, he's a great example of how to influence change, and he's been very positive about sign language. He values deaf people, their culture and their community. He wants that to continue. And he's aware of the impact of everyday issues and the barriers that we face as a community. You know, there's been lots of campaigns and things like that, and there's been legal issues, but we still have to campaign to influence things on a legal level. But Jeremy Corbyn, he listens to people, he's kind-hearted, he knows what's going on, he's passionate about our campaigns and our issues, as opposed to being a bland legal kind of person. And I think Jeremy Corbyn should be Prime Minister, because the Conservatives are continuing to ignore people. Hi everyone, hello. My name is Tom Lychee. Really, I'm just standing here to say, I'm not gonna talk about deaf issues specifically per se, I want to talk about everyone. Everyone that's here today, you've got your own diverse experiences and a wealth of knowledge between us. And lots of people have been campaigning about the government stopping this, stopping that, and all that. And it's all like very from a very negative perspective. I think we should think about more creative solutions in regards to the messages that we give, in regards to creating issues and opportunities for deaf people and disabled people within government. You know, and because at the moment it's kind of like we're being dictated to, like, oh, this could help you and all that, talking on our behalf, but we should be a bit more collaborative in regards to policies and things that we want. So there's just a couple of things I just wanted to raise and give you a bit of food for thought. And let's just think about solutions that will help everyone and not just individuals. And also money and budgets, where is this going to come from? It's very complex in terms of when you want to challenge people and things like that. But I think getting a positive message will help us get more support from everybody wider. Thank you very much.
Hi, yeah, I'm Mark Dunk. I'm a member of the London and Eastern Unite Disabled Members Committee. I just think it's not that surprising, really, to see the sort of tricks that we're seeing from the Labour right, really, because there's one thing that Jeremy can do that they can't do, really, and that's inspire people. When I first met Jeremy Corbyn, it was on one of my first London demonstrations. I went on a march for London Metropolitan University, and Corbyn was there on the stump at the rally chatting about saving the local college for working class people in that area of London. And it's no surprise that, again, when London Met is under attack, there's 400 job governor just the other day, Jeremy's meeting up with one of the victimised reps that's trying to fight to save that college. When you look at that, that inspires people. That inspires people who've suffered under those cuts. When you look at the other side, you look at Owen Smith, he can't even inspire his own campaign team at his own launch to even smile for the photograph. If you look at the young woman behind him holding the sign saying Owen Smith, the leader of the Labour Party, she doesn't look that interested, to be honest. Like, so I think we've probably got a decent chance of Jeremy winning the leadership contest that's unfortunately been forced upon the Labour Party, and I think that'll be a good thing for the whole of the left. But the other side of it, really, I think that we can't afford to forget is the main enemy is the Tories. I think Paul's right to say he's sick of the Tories. He's right to say we've got to get them out. So one thing that people should think is, like, we've got to get this battle done. We've got to get Jeremy to win. But also, sort of around the time that leadership election is going to finish, there's going to be conference season, isn't there? The Tories are going to be holding their conference in Birmingham. What we can't lose sight of in the next couple of months is trying to make sure that there's a massive demonstration on the 2nd of October at the Tory Party conference in Birmingham, making sure that Theresa May's government knows it ain't welcome. It wasn't voted in. We don't want what they're going to bring, which will be more of the same, more cuts, more attacks on disabled people, more attacks on working class people as a whole, and we need to be there in massive numbers, disabled people uniting, black people, everyone that is getting hit at the moment needs to be united there to say Tories out and hopefully Corbyn in.
Another couple of contributions from disabled people who couldn't be here today and who actually helped to organise today. So Nathan, who's a Labour Party member from North Wales, he says, "I just want to add my support for Jeremy Corbyn from my base in North Wales. I'm sorry I can't be there this evening, but I'm there in spirit. It's difficult to sum up how important this new brand of inclusive politics is to those of us who often feel abandoned and isolated on the edges of a cruel right-wing society. I've been particularly hurt by the closure of the Independent Living Fund, as I have a progressive disability that means my needs will increase over time. I'm still stuck with the same limited hours of care that I was given 6 years ago, with little hope of receiving an increase in the near future. This often means being left alone during the afternoon, which can lead to numerous accidents through no fault of my own. I shouldn't have to live like this, and I'm doing all I can to ensure that no one has to suffer such indignities and barriers to independent living. This is our chance to make far-reaching changes in our society, and I believe that the vast majority of the disabled community support Jeremy Corbyn to deliver this positive change, as he has supported us in our countless battles against the Tories. Finally, I'd like to thank John McDonnell as well as Jeremy Corbyn for providing disabled activists such as myself with hope. Hope that we can defeat the Tories, hope that we can build a fairer society, and most of all, the hope that one day we can achieve full equality under a new type of politics. Thank you, Nathan Lee Davey." Then there's one from Bob Ellard. Bob is a member of the DPAC steering group. He plays an amazing role for DPAC. He's also a Labour Party member in Dartford. And he says, "Dear Jeremy, with you as Labour leader, I can dare to hope I'll never have to be in fear of having another humiliating work capability assessment. I know you won't let us down, and I know we won't let you down. Together we can do this, Bob." Mary's just checking on John, whether he's got stuck somewhere, but I don't know. I know Roger wants to make a contribution. Should we go to Roger? Yeah.
We've got lots of
Okay, thanks very much. I've been asked to sum up this evening's gathering, this evening's meeting, with a few words. In a way, I hope I'm not summing up, and I hope maybe we will get a chance to hear from John. But as we've heard, at the moment, both John and Jeremy are extremely busy with a huge number of calls on them. I'll say a few words now that I think might kind of be useful in where we go from here, when we go home this evening and get up tomorrow, back in our communities, back in our campaigns, in our workplaces. Thinking back on the tremendous and excellent contributions we've heard here this evening, but also then sort of thinking about what the task is ahead and where we need to go away from here. And I don't want to sort of rake over all the coals of the referendum campaign, but I think there's a couple of issues that are worth thinking about that kind of I'd like to put forward and then say how I think that helps us see where we need to go from here. And that's recognising that when we look on social media, when we're talking to people in the days after the referendum result, there's a whole lot of fear out there, both from disabled people and in particular from the BME community. I mean, I know looking at the DPAC website and the posts on Facebook and things like that, disabled people saying seriously that they were thinking about the sticks and having to move to Scotland because they were frightened of what the Tories were going to continue to do. And when you look at similar sentiments from members of the BME community, with a feeling that we now live in a deeply racist country because of how the referendum reflected racist views and particularly around immigration, and that this was a scary place. I think we need to be very clear about recognising that those feelings are very, very real for those who are expressing those views. But I also think they're mistaken views, and this is very, very important. This is the point I want to make. Because when we look at the referendum, it was dominated completely by two sides. On the one side, a racist Tory Remain argument, and on the other side, a racist Tory Leave argument. We didn't get any positive argument from any other real source. And in large part, that's because of the actions of the right wing within the Labour Party, who used the election, the referendum campaign, to continue the attacks, the digs at Jeremy Corbyn and the stabbing in his back, and indeed picked up on much of this racist rhetoric, echoing the racism that was out there. So what's this got to do with disabled people? Well, of all groups, we understand scapegoating, don't we? The scapegoating that we've been seeing against asylum seekers, against immigrants and migrant workers in the referendum campaign, mirrors exactly the scapegoating of disabled people we've seen under this government for the last 5-6 years. And we know that that can run very deep, and that without that being challenged, people can accept some of those ideas in a general way. People did, I think, in the referendum accept that, yeah, there are too many migrant workers here, but not necessarily the people that I work with who are in the same hospital and running the hospitals and the schools and everything else that we're doing. In the same way that they've taken on ideas that, yeah, there are a lot of disabled people out there who are scroungers, but not that guy in the wheelchair who lives next door to me, or my mother who's got mental health issues. And I think that is what we need to remember and what we need to be confident about coming out of here. And that's the policies, the hope, the confidence that Jeremy Corbyn and the movement around him represent. And that means our job is to go out and be confident in building that movement and building that unity, both amongst disabled people and our movement, deaf and disabled people. And I think it's tremendously important that we've got so many deaf people here today, and have been throughout, back at the Deaf March here in London last September, and the involvement in deaf people around the Stop Changes campaign, but also the engagement of so many people with mental health difficulties in our campaign, and so many people with learning disabilities in our campaigns. I think this is tremendously important, because it strengthens our movement and makes it stronger. And that gives us confidence in taking on this government right back. But we also, yeah, I think John's here, so I'm gonna shut up.
I'm very glad to see him, and I'll just hand over now.
Thanks a lot. I'm sorry I'm late. We've been voting at the Commons, and we've been fighting off other elements of the plot, the coup that's going on at the moment. Let me just say this. Last September, something happened that I suppose never expected to see again in my lifetime. And that was, we had a socialist elected as the leader of the Labour Party. Now, it came as a shock to the whole of the system and the whole of the establishment. And since then, to be frank, almost from the first moment Jeremy was elected, the system and the establishment have been coming at us. Now, some of you may remember, when he was elected, literally within 2 minutes of the start of his speech to thank people for the support they got, on the television screens, the coup had already started, because you saw flashed across the bottom people announcing that they were refusing to serve for Jeremy.
That's right.
people resigning for the shadow cabinet that then existed. So it started then. 10 months on, they've been looking at any opportunity to actually undermine Jeremy, undermine the administration, and then topple him. That's what's been happening, and that's what this is about. And it's not, this is the establishment saying to all of us, how dare you elect a socialist as the leader of the Labour Party? That's what this is all about. And it's not about Jeremy Corbyn, it's about you.
That's right.
It's about you.
That's right.
The reason is because for the first time in, well, generations, we have a leader of the Labour Party who's willing to take on the establishment, willing to challenge the social injustices of our society, and is, well, his ambition is to form an administration that will give power back to the people. Now, the system cannot tolerate that. This is the first time they've had a Labour leader for a long period of time that they can't just incorporate into the system, because that's what usually happens. Labour leaders get set, they make a few noises, challenging noises, but then they rapidly get incorporated into the system. In addition to that, what they want, the establishment wants to do, is just to return to politics as normal, which is about the rotation of the elites, nothing more than that. So that's why it was inevitable that they were going to come for us. And we knew the coup was going on, we knew the plot was going on. Originally what they were going to do is launch the plot after the Oldham by-election, because they said Jeremy couldn't win elections. But we won the Oldham by-election with a thumping result. We went on then, and the next timing of the coup was to be after the local government elections. The problem then is that we won all the mayoral elections, and we reached in terms of our local councils, we held on to all the councils that they thought we'd lose, and we gained the maximum number of seats that Miliband ever dared to. And we had spectacular victories. It wasn't just in London, but I tell you, having Marvin, a black man, elected mayor in Bristol,
yes,
is money based on slavery.
Awesome.
So it didn't come after that. And then they used the excuse of the referendum result as the way in which to launch the plot. What then happened is that a few weeks ago on a Saturday, we got contacted by The Observer to say that Hilary Benn was phoning around shadow cabinet members urging them to resign. So Jeremy phoned up Hilary Benn to find out what was going on. It was late at night. Hilary Benn admitted it, and Jeremy offered him to pull back, just issue a statement, we'll resolve it. He refused. So what could he do? What could Jeremy do? He had to sack him. He sacked him that night. And then what happened is they started resigning in waves, and that was the plot. The first four resigned, and we thought we'd get stabilised situation. Then the next four resigned. Then it went on like that. But what happened? We appointed a new shadow cabinet. And the young people that came forward to serve in that new shadow cabinet, to be frank, have been brilliant. They've been heroes and heroines of this group. And I tell you this, it's given me some ideas about how you slim down government. What then has happened is that at the National Executive Committee, they first of all tried to keep Jeremy off the ballot paper. A legal opinion was given to the Labour Party months ago, saying he's automatically on the ballot paper. It's the challengers who have to get nominations to do that. But then they challenged that at the NEC, and we won that vote. We had to get a separate legal opinion, yet again, two legal opinions, arguing the case, and that happened. But what's happened since then? A rich donor for the Labour Party has come forward and is challenging in court. The trial will be next Tuesday. We're in court at the moment to make sure Jeremy's properly represented. We'll have that decision tomorrow, then the full hearing will be next Tuesday. This is one rich donor, with most probably other financial backing, trying to prevent 500,000 people having the right to a free democratic election. It's unacceptable. But in addition to that, as you know, what happened was we won the vote in terms of keeping Jeremy on the ballot paper. That's been legally challenged. Then people left the NEC meeting. One person went back, her husband is disabled and has to feed him on a regular basis, went back. Another had to get the last train up to Runcorn. And they then laid round a paper, not on the agenda, laid it round, and that introduced a 6-month qualification period and increased from £3 the amount that you had to pay to become a registered supporter, £25. And that was bounced through. 14-14 the vote, and it carried in that way. I think that was a scandal. That is denying 140,000 people the right to vote. So
it's a poll tax.
14 people denying 140,000 people the right to vote. Why is that happening? Because they're terrified that most of those people registered when they knew Jeremy was under threat and they would vote to Jeremy to be leader again. Now again, it looks as though some of the members have been denied that right. It might be that they will be challenging that in court as well. But they've applied the 6-month ban, the 6-month retrospective membership, not just to party members, but also to trade union registered spirits as well. Again, there may be some unions that will be challenging that decision too. This is a coup. This is a very British coup that's going on here by a small group of people who've always literally wanted to hold on to their power base, working with the establishment to ensure democracy doesn't prevail, not just in our party, but also within our society. And I tell you what's been good, I've been doing meetings up and down the country, literally packed out meetings, where people are coming forward and asserting their right to vote and asserting their right to a democratic say in the future of our party. Because you know as well as I do what would happen if Jeremy's no longer leader. We'd go back to the old system. They go back to how leaders are elected. They go back to how MPs are selected. They go back to where the centre controls rather than members themselves who actually make up this party have democratic control over our party. And yet again, they'll become just an alternative elite elected into government every now and again when the establishment lets them. I don't think that's acceptable. And I don't think the people who joined the party, the 500,000 members that we've now got, and supporters, I think the bulk of them find that unacceptable as well. And as I say, this isn't about Jeremy Corbyn. This is about all of us. This isn't an injury to Jeremy Corbyn. It's an injury to us. In fact, now, to be frank, we're all Jeremy Corbyn.
That's right.
Because that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to undermine the democratic rights of party members.
That's right.
I believe... Just say this, I've known Jeremy for 35, nearly 40 years, campaigned alongside him all throughout. You know as well as I do, in terms of the campaigns that we've had around issues around disability, around the WCA, around PIP and all the rest of it, Jeremy's been with us on every occasion, in the meetings, on the demonstrations, in the direct action, he supports us in Parliament, supports us in the Labour Party, and supports us throughout. Now he's given us that solidarity. To be frank, I think we owe him our solidarity too.
Absolutely.
And that's why in these coming weeks, we'll know next Tuesday after the court case whether Jeremy's definitely on the ballot paper. If he is on the ballot paper, I am urging people, all of those who are party members, all of those who have the vote, to actually then start mobilising them in mass numbers. We're up against an incredibly well-funded, quite powerful machine that's moving against us now to wrest control of the Labour Party away from its membership, and as I say, to be going back to the control of the establishment again. I think that's a struggle worth fighting, because if we can elect Jeremy Corbyn as leader again, it's saying out there, we don't just want to ensure that we have democracy in the Labour Party. We're coming to establish true democracy within our society. Yeah. Just this final point, really. The atmosphere in Parliament has been grim, to be honest. What Jeremy's had to put up with by levels of, to be frank, abuse at times.
Yeah.
I've never seen anybody experience it. Never, ever. And he's come through it
with his calm, determined dignity, and he's won even more respect from people for that. When we, this argument that he can't win elections, apart from the parliamentary by-elections, apart from the local government elections, the mayor elections, the irony of it is that on the night when in the parliamentary Labour Party people were getting up to say you've got to stand down because we'll never win an election with you, etc., the first item on the agenda was to welcome the parliamentary candidate from Tooting had just tripled their majority. So we can't win elections under Jeremy Corbyn. We had one that night. They're also saying he's not a leader. I do not want a leader back like Blair or any of the others. He's not their type of leader. He's our type of leader. He's someone who's democratically accountable, who brings people together. He works on the basis of consensual politics. He works on the basis of democratic engagement. Never again do we want a Blair-type leader who makes the decisions, like taking us to the war in Iraq with what the Chilcot demonstrated was unsatisfactory legal advice, a lack of preparedness with our troops that put them at risk, and resulted in, well, we think, at least 500,000 deaths. That's not the sort of leader I ever want again. I want someone who'll work democratically, engagingly, constructively, bringing people together, consensus building, searching for peace, tackling social injustices. That's why we elected Jeremy Corbyn as our leader, and that's why in these coming months, no matter what they throw at us, we've got to stand together in solidarity and ensure he's re-elected again. Solidarity.
Great and fantastic to hear from you, John. Thanks so much. I think that'll be.
I've got to go to a meeting in Ealing.
Holy.
Well, I'll get there in the last 10 minutes. But what's happened there, through various manipulations, the people have been thrown out of the hall, so they're holding the meeting in the street.
What? Oh, shit.
So I'm going to go down because I think they're blocking the traffic.
Just make sure we keep this
result
and hold on
to
as many buses for as long as possible.
Yeah,
and
tell
him to raise a hand,
we'll
come down.
Yeah. Thanks, Tom. Okay, off to another meeting. Yes.
I was just saying that Deepak has launched a letter in support of Jeremy Corbyn. You can sign it on the website, but you can also sign a paper copy at the back of the room. Thank you. So, and I'd also like to thank all our speakers again, and also thank you to Unite for providing the room for us to meet.
Sorry, what's the website address?
The website for Deepak is...
The website for Deepak, www.dpac.uk.net.
Okay, guys, you got that. And sign as well. Thank you, UK watching. Carl, Bruce the Girl, Occupy Kaylin, thank you so much for being with us. That was wonderful. Unfortunately, there were two meetings. One is Deepak, then I was actually by Occupy, and I couldn't go to the Occupy one. Okay, so that's it. I'm hoping that somebody managed to live stream that one, or somebody made a recording because I wouldn't want to see it. Okay, guys, thank you. Okay, thank you, Yuki, watching. I shall not sure when there's another meeting or demo, but hopefully I shall be there. I've been so hot. Thank you so much. Anyway, I'm hoping that the live streams are okay. I should have actually made more a point of actually pointing towards the interpreters, the signers, but we'll see. Anyway, thank you. Guys, okay, peace out. See you later. See you later. Bye.
That's all right.
Bye.
John is a good man.